Gareth. Welcome. Welcome to the Bank of England. Thank you all for making the time to come in, and thank you for participating over the course of the last several weeks, couple months, in the Future Forum. Appreciate your post. You're here because you posted and you were engaged and gave us ideas, and so we appreciate that. This slightly odd room is where we do a lot of our work. This is where we meet as the Monetary Policy Committee and the Financial Policy Committee, and then have a number of our colleagues who tell us what to think, tell us what's going on, what to think. Sometimes it's more successful than others. It's also where we have press conferences. But obviously the point of the Future Forum is not to hear from the press, although we're always happy to hear the press's priorities, but to hear from people like yourselves, broad range of people who are interested in these topics. And what we had done in the past is, last few years, is to go to various places around the country, you know, sort of one-day event to reach out, and the idea here was to do so virtually and get feedback that way. As you may know, the bank was founded 325 years ago, and its purpose was to promote the good of the people. The way we do that today is to promote monetary and financial stability, and you know, the question is, what does that exactly mean? And in effect, what it means is four things about money. The first is that we make money, literally. We create the fives, tens, twenties, and fifties that people use in transactions. And one of the dynamics in that, is, of course, is that the frequency with which people are using that has been going down over the years. It's still the second most frequently used means of payment. But when I first came here about 5 years ago, 5.5 years ago, it was around 60% of payments, transactions were with cash, and today it's about a third. So there's been quite a notable change, and there's some obvious reasons for that. So, but the first thing is we make cash, and our job is to make sure that it's people have confidence in it, you know, that it's secure, that it's durable, and now, very importantly, that it's green. And that is the case with the new polymer notes and the new 50 coming out, new 20 coming out. When's the new 20 coming out? Later this year?
Early next year.
Early next year. Thank you. That's our chief cashier who's been practicing her signature for that new 20. The second thing we do with money is we process it. We process every payment in the United Kingdom. Ultimately comes through the Bank of England, and that means every day about £600 billion worth of payments comes through the systems of the Bank of England, and of course that has to be absolutely resilient, sort of Phi Sigma levels of resilient, perfect, and so we spend a tremendous effort there, and we may get into that core payment system. The acronym is something called RTGS. We may get into talking a bit about that over the course of this afternoon, because it's one of the ways we can influence the future of money. Third thing we do with money is to preserve its value, and that's to keep inflation low, stable, predictable. We have a remit, a mandate from Parliament to target inflation, to keep inflation on average at 2% for consumer prices, so that people can plan accordingly. And the last, but certainly not the least, thing we do with respect to money is to keep it secure. In other words, to keep the banks at the core of the system and the financial system itself resilient, so that people don't have a repeat of the experience of 2007-08, when they became worried about whether their money would be there when they went to take it out of a bank or building society. And actually, we have, and we can talk about it, turned the system around, the financial system around, so it's a source of resilience as opposed to fragility. All of those things in the end are about confidence in the financial system, confidence in money, and of course money is just a means to an end. So the purpose of the Future Forum over the last several weeks and this afternoon is to talk obviously about the future of money, all aspects of money, whatever aspects of money you want to direct us to. We know that its use is changing rapidly. We think there's going to be even bigger changes to come. There's a revolution in how we pay for things, from cash to contactless and to QR codes and potentially beyond. Society is changing as well, the needs of society, whether it's an aging population, how people save for the future, the demands of millennials, the expectations for a real-time distributed economy. Talk about that. Major issues, major structural changes like climate change happening as well, and that does cause some adaptations for how we fulfill our four core functions. So a chance to talk a bit about what we're doing, a chance to be pushed on what more we should be doing, what we should think about. This event is being streamed live online, and people who are following online can submit questions on Twitter and also join the live polls, and I'll come to those live polls in a second. We're going to try to divide this into three parts. I'm going to hand over to Ben Broadbent, who is the Deputy Governor for Monetary Policy, to kick off a tribute to ABBA, Money, 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 which will look at financial innovation and its impact on financial services, our economy, and what we're doing to safeguard both. Then Dave Ramsden, who's our Director for Markets and Banking, will lead a session on banking in the new world, again, looking at financial innovation and its implications for financial stability, what we're doing to keep money safe as the system changes quite dramatically. And then after that, Joe Place, who's our Deputy Governor, Chief Operating Officer, and Sam Woods, who's there, who is in charge of the PRA. The PRA is the arm of the bank that oversees all the banks, building societies, and insurance companies, credit unions as well, in the United Kingdom. So tremendous responsibilities there. And they're looking at how we're managing changing financial risk, because there's a lot of exciting changes in the system, and we want to make sure those bed down and have the biggest benefit to households and businesses across the United Kingdom, while keeping that system resilient and secure. Remember my fourth thing on money. So with that, slightly long introduction, but hopefully somewhat useful. I'd like to get things going. Start by asking our first question, which we're using a polling system called the Mentimeter for this. Okay, so if you're online, you can access it by going to www.menti, that's menti.com, and enter the event code displayed on the screen, which is 622659, I see. And the first question is very straightforward, which is, do you have any cash on you today? And there are five possible answers now. I hope you brought some of our product into the bank, and we will exchange it. The answer options are less than 10, 11 to 20, 21 to 50, over 50, and E, I never carry cash. Full disclosure, I'm in the green bucket there, the 21 to 50. I will.
After my experience on the cash versus cashless challenge, I'm now in the pink bucket.
Good. You're a bit short for the cashless. You're cashless in the cash versus cashless challenge, okay. Okay. So we're settling down. It's interesting that, okay, we had I never carry cash, but we also have less than 10, which could mean not carrying cash, but not admitting to never carrying cash, which would be. So we've been slightly ambiguous there, but bias, some cash, fairly wide distribution, consistent. You can't quite extrapolate from that, but if you take the numbers from last year, a sense that about 30% or about a third of people still use cash as their main means of payment. So principal means of payment, It also happens to be roughly that percentage of transactions are with cash. So, with card now now in first place. Okay, so with that, and the results still coming in, but yellow in the lead. If anyone would like to take out some cash and just bump up the higher numbers, that would be. With that, I'd like to hand over to Ben to lead us through.
Thank you very much. So, as the governor just said, we've seen quite a steep decline in the last few years in the use of cash for payments. Funnily enough, at the same time, the overall quantity of cash has continued to rise, which is interesting and tells one that even if they're not using it in transactions, there are people who are seeking to store it, maybe for other reasons. So the overall stock of notes we provide has gone up, even as relative to the size of the economy over the last 10 years. Nevertheless, the transactions use has clearly fallen quite steeply, and if you look at some other countries where electronic payments, where they've moved before us in a sense or ahead of us, Sweden, in some respects China, there's no sign that we can expect that fall to continue over the next few years, possibly at some points quite precipitously. However, having said that, there were a number of interesting issues that came out of this cash versus cashless thing, particularly those about financial inclusion. Dave, I'm going to ask you just very quickly, when you said that you wanted to move buckets, did you discover that not using banknotes had a cost?
Well, no, it was more that, I decided to do the challenge because I'm going increasingly cashless. There was certainly a cost to being caught short when I was trying to pay for dinner in a pub. I had to borrow some off a friend. It was just a reminder that actually having a bit of cash is useful to even in London, where it's very easy to go, or much easier to go contactless, and there are lots more ATMs than there are, say, in rural places. It still was a reminder to me of the importance of cash.
And I think that what we found from some of the responses here, I mean, to tell you the truth, or this confirm what we already knew, is that there are some parts of the population for whom it's critical and don't even have bank accounts. That's long been the case. And rely on cash, partly for budgeting reasons. So there are some bits of the population where it's still exclusively used. And, we as the Bank of England are responsible for reducing the banknotes. We're responsible for the wholesale distribution of those banknotes and storing them. We're not responsible for the retail bit, the ATMs, but clearly there are questions of financial inclusion raised. Were we ever to, or were cash to disappear entirely, it's clear there'll be some people who'd be sort of left behind by that and who wouldn't have any financial services available to them at all. I don't know anyone around the table, they're probably everyone that I can see. I mean, this is true over time, of course, everyone gets younger than me. It becomes more and more apparent. But I doubt anyone around this table, as far as I can see, would be wholly reliant on cash. In some sense, maybe our survey was slightly skewed, but we know that there are big segments of the population who just have no other option, or at least rely on it very heavily. So our policy at the moment is simply to meet the demand for cash wherever that goes. Formally, we have no prior, we're not the regulator for the retail end, we just supply exactly what people want, whether that goes up or down, but we can see these issues coming, or increasing rather, as the retail demand declines. I don't know, Sarah, if you want to say anything about the most very recent trends and how we track those, and this contrast between the stock going up overall and yet the retail use declining.
I think most of the key statistics around this have already been covered. The governor already mentioned that, you know, about a third of transactions are conducted in cash. That makes it just the second most popular form of payment method, but that has fallen quite sharply. So just a year before, it was 40% of transactions. So 40% down to 34% over a year is quite a steep decline. As Ben said, we are still issuing as many notes as we ever have done. It's about just over 70 billion of notes in circulation. And so what that tells us is that people are using cash still, but for other things as well. We understand that quite a lot of people, particularly in a low interest environment, like to store cash, use cash as a store of value. So actually we are seeing basically flat notes in circulation. The number of notes in circulation, quantity of notes in circulation is staying roughly flat. But obviously we've got this underlying fall in the value of transactions being conducted in cash, which is quite an interesting dynamic actually. So, you know, some of the things that we're doing is working with industry to really understand what's behind those trends, to understand what's driving those, you know, movements. I mean, personally, I think we are on a move, and as came clear in the forum, a lot of people think that move towards a lower cash society is likely to continue. But I think what's important to remember is there will be a proportion of the population who continue to want to use cash. It's important that they have the choice to continue to use cash, and at the bank we're committed to providing them with that choice. As the Governor said, I'm responsible for the banknote production. We're just moving all our banknotes over onto polymer. You've got the fives and the tens, you'll have seen those. The 20 comes out next year, and we've Beautiful announced note. We're going to do a 50 as well. And that's all about making sure that our currency, you know, our banknotes, are sustainable, people can spend them with confidence, and so they're going to be, you know, safe, cleaner, safer, stronger than the paper banknotes that we had before. And that's because we at the bank see that there will be a future demand for cash for, you know, the foreseeable future, and we are investing in the technology to make sure that we have banknotes that are really at the cutting edge, so that people can use them with a lot of confidence.
Yes, that's a question.
When are we going to lose 1p and 2p?
We, funny enough, we're slightly odd in this country, but we don't produce the coins. We only produce or distribute the coins. We only produce the notes. We did actually, there was a government proposal from the Treasury that we stop using very, very small coins, and I think we submitted an opinion to that, or I can't remember if we did or didn't, but...
There are a few national newspapers who submitted an opinion.
Well, yes, submitting opinions is the business of national newspapers. In this particular case, I think we did say somewhere in some form that we didn't think it would have a material effect on inflation, and it is the case that that particular form of physical currency has declined in use very significantly. And there is some cost to producing these things. So I didn't think we had a strong opinion about that, because it's not our business to produce them or circulate them.
Yeah. No, there was we had a similar thing in Canada about 7 or 8 years ago, and prior to that in Australia and New Zealand, which was to look at the equivalent of the 1p piece. And you get these fluctuations in commodity prices when it costs more than the value of the coin, even with very sophisticated plating technology. And in those other countries, other members of the Commonwealth, the judgment was in the end that it made sense to discontinue them. And of course, one of the core questions was exactly as Ben just said, was would retailers round up or round down? And the evidence is that actually doesn't have any effect on inflation for a few reasons. One of them is actually many, and part of what we're discussing here is a lot of transactions are not with cash, and therefore if you're using your contactless card, if it's £2.97, it's still, or £2.99, it's still £2.99. Secondly, people often buy a number of things together, and so the value changes. And thirdly, there's this little thing called competition, and that also disciplines, on average, at least in the experience of those other countries now. But it's a decision of the government. I don't think it's a live issue, to be honest, because it was debated a few years, 2 years ago or so, I think, and the will of the people was not to not to.
Yes. Sorry.
Can I come back to the question of access to cash?
Yes, of course.
Obviously, certain sectors of our population tend to use it more than others. The elderly, perhaps. I have in mind a question about the closure of post offices, and they were quite a sensible route for elderly people to be able to get their cash. So the question to me really is in terms of the Bank of England, how much influence or do you have in terms of where cash can be accessed in terms of ATMs or post offices, or are you able to strong arm a little bit and say, you know, we need to provide comprehensive access to cash? Is not happening, maybe, as a question.
I mean, it, you know, we certainly have our views known. We're not the regulator of that system, but we would certainly make our views known. I think so far we've been fortunate. That would be wrong, because we can see this increasing. This problem is likely to carry on. But it is the case that the banks and the people who provide the ATMs are conscious of it, and, you know, Link, for example, subsidizes now relative to city centres. Where the demand is lower, and where the problem is probably less, it subsidizes ATMs elsewhere. And banks have been under some moral suasion, I think, that even when they're closing branches, which reflects the general trends towards internet banking and so forth, they nonetheless retain ATMs. But I think you're right to raise it, because one can only see that problem growing over time.
Yeah.
And it's an important issue.
Yeah, I might just bring in Sam Woods, if I could, in his role as... So Sam oversees the safety and soundness of banks, and this is a customer access issue, but it's an important issue, and as Ben says, it's something actually we do spend some time on. So
yes, Sam. So thanks, Mark. So it's very... I'm touching on the branch closure aspect in particular, which is obviously an important part of this. I mean, obviously that has been a very significant program in recent years and is still ongoing. So, you know, on our numbers, it's about a third or 3,000 branches over a four-year period. But as Ben was saying, that does, of course, partly reflect changing behaviours as well. So for one of our banks, and I think they're big enough to be illustrative of the population as a whole, the volume of business going through the branches is down 40% over a two- or three-year period, and the volume of online and through the phone is up by a similar amount. So all of that is in the mix, but it does leave questions about access for those who are not part of those trends in particular. I wonder if I might be able to draw in Mo, but are we allowed to reveal that you are, in fact, ramblings of a bard?
Yes.
I'm afraid I just have. So
if he says no, I think
that's
it might
just
be a
too
bit
bad.
Late.
It's out there now.
Is he also Banksy?
Yeah. Can I just ban any ramblings, though, in this session? That's really not allowed. But Mo made a very popular post in a session I was having, which was exactly on this. And you raised an interesting case of the homeless people, and the mayor had some kind of a project going. And, you know, it made me think of aspects of this debate. And one, just before I pass over Mo to you, maybe to explain what you said in your post, there's a complex intersection here also with the government's digital strategy, because the FCA did some quite interesting research which showed that only 23% of people in rural areas do their banking on their phone, compared to 45% in urban areas. Mm-hmm. Now, there may be behavioural, but there's certainly also an infrastructure dimension to that. But
yeah, I mean, it's an essential issue, because there is if you're just on cash, there's a cost to it. So you're missing out on online deals, you're missing out on opportunities to have quicker payments. But then there's the other side of it, where there are trends happening where, for example, in China, the government is actively training people to start using smartphones. In London, the street buskers are testing card readers, so that people who would be outside of the system would come inside the system. So while they're both sides of the trend here, that, okay, there are still people stuck in the in the access to cash problem, but then, okay, you're helping them reach out to other forms of payments and payment methods. So, I think it's that's why one of the posts that I had on the forum was taking everybody together, because there's a vast demography of people with different types of uses for cash. Some people, I think 17% of the population is dependent on cash, which is a big number. It's like 8.5 million people that are truly dependent on cash. So if you close off access to cash, then the alternate strategy for the government or for payment providers will be, how do you train them to use other methods?
I think that, you know, you're right that maybe the government should seek to do that, and it's been a long-standing problem, long before digital payments, that some people didn't have bank accounts. And bank accounts always offered more financial services than not having one, and that's just becoming truer now than it was. And I suspect that even those with bank accounts, you know, some people would not want cash to disappear entirely. And I'd note that in China, where the central bank is the regulator of these systems, they actually go after and try and discipline. If they find retailers, for example, who no longer accept cash, they will, you know, correct them, and they will say, "Well, you have to accept it because there are." Well, they will, because, you know, that's clearly the temptation. So even in societies where there's much more widespread use, and, you know, maybe they may aren't so conscious, they will go out of their way to protect the cash infrastructure.
So can I just, we'll go to you, Richard, in a second, but I just make two sort of supplemental points. One is that in the UK, as many of you will know, but legal tender, you don't have to accept banknotes. So you wouldn't have that analogous situation where we would go to regulators and say, you must accept cash. So if you're a retailer out there and you're following this, don't worry, you can be contactless. You might lose some custom because some people continue to like to use cash. The second point, Sam referenced, there are obligations of banks to take into account. We don't oversee this aspect of their behavior, but there are obligations and things they have to take into account when they're thinking about branch closures and or ATM adjustments. It is the fact that about, Sam, a third of the branches have closed over the course of, let's say, the last 5 years. And a lot of those, you know, there's areas that have been certainly affected. Be careful on judging, you know, potentially disproportionately. And this issue of access to cash and access to banking is becoming more important. And there's a review by, in fact, the ATM industry is doing they've commissioned an independent review on exactly this issue in terms of access to ATMs and therefore to cash. What we come at it from the other side, which is, as Sarah says, you know, making sure that we have notes that you can use, that are that you can have confidence in, that are green, and that are very cost effective. The fact that they have more security features on them mean they last longer, and you can trust them for longer. And also thinking about how we distribute it in a way that is as efficient as possible, so to make the access point as efficient as possible. But sorry, Richard, you wanted to come in.
Governor, thank you very much indeed for this event. It's really very welcome indeed. I tried to correspond with the bank in past years before you came, and it was tricky. But I have a particular thing that I wanted to raise about who creates and owns the nation's money. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering, I would love not to go away from this afternoon without having had some opportunity to raise it with you. And I was just wondering if you could explain the sort of the agenda of the layout of the afternoon how we're going to proceed.
Would like to do what I propose. Why don't we just table that for 5 minutes, basically, Ben? We can address the other issues, if I may, with respect to physical cash, mm-hmm. and then we'll come back to, and actually I'll ask Ben to say a word on how money is created, because, as you know, by the nature of your question, and others would have a sense, is that the Bank of England creates notes, Royal Mint creates coins, we create something called central bank reserves, But then most of the money is created actually by the private financial system, and we can talk through that and how that's disciplined. So that's, we'll hang on to that as a question, but.
Come right, the only thing I have to do is to ask Gareth whether there are any better questions on this issue.
I have some for a bit later, so can we postpone that, park that for now, and then we'll come back to those a bit later.
Okay. Maybe there was one question.
Can I just raise, and I'm slightly, Governor, slightly self-conscious about doing this, but one of the old systems for paying cash was paying in cash as a means of transactions that weren't recorded in some way, and certainly in some countries I've lived in, that was quite a common activity. My basic question is, how much of the transactions are you picking up? And is there anything about the store of money? Is that money that's hanging around, so to speak? Is it storage, or is it transactional, but
well,
you're not picking it up?
Well, you're absolutely right that what we deduce to be storage is in some sense the residual from how much we produce versus what the surveys tell us is the transactional use. And it could be that the black market use is growing very rapidly. I mean, I don't think we have any reason to believe that it would grow more quickly than the economy. And I would point out that, you know, we have never had, to the same extent as some other countries, the very high denomination notes that increase the use of cash for. I've no doubt that people, one of the reasons people like it in the back of it is some sort of anonymity value, for good or ill, but we don't have the very high denomination notes. Our highest note is lower in value than in the US and in the euro area that encourage that sort of use, and I don't think we have any reason to think that it's sort of gone up a lot, whatever the level is in recent years, would you say? I mean, obviously, by its nature, it's hard to say exactly what it is.
Just anecdotally, I mean, one of the things that we have seen recently is an increase in demand since the referendum results in overseas demand for notes. As the exchange rate has shifted, we've seen an increase in demand for notes from overseas. So we think that quite a bit of the store of value is actually people holding sterling as from overseas as well. So it's not, you know, don't look at those figures and think it must all be something like that. There are valid, very valid reasons that people hold sterling and banknotes as a store of value.
Thank you very much. That's
which referendum?
Yes, there's one more question and then we'd better move on because I think.
Can I just add a quick point on anonymity? You touched on it there, but how does the bank think about anonymity of payments? Because a banknote is anonymous, bank payment is maybe a bit more traceable. Obviously, there are reasons you might want to curb anonymity for cracking down on the black market, but maybe there's a kind of a right to privacy from having that in a banknote.
Yeah, I mean, I'll start, which is, I think, Daniel, that's exactly right. It rises to a level well above us, which is determining people's right to privacy. I mean, and this is one of the issues, as you're anticipating, with a fully digital economy, digital financial system, in that in the end, everything can potentially be traceable, including. Many of the crypto and other innovations in the end are have a chain to them and discoverable. So those are bigger, much bigger political questions. And it is a question, if I can add to it, which is around a very speculative issue at this stage in terms of technology, and I'm not sending any signal around this, but in terms of sometimes what's debated is around a so-called central bank digital currency. So could everyone have, could we have our own tokenized currency, which is an analog to a crypto currency, but actually backed by the central bank and the institutions? Or alternatively, could everyone have an account at the Bank of England and transactions would be ledgered through through the Bank of England? In both cases, there are many issues related to that, including that actually some of the innovations we're going to talk about later and where they lead, private innovations and where they lead, could be much more efficient and effective ways of accomplishing the same ultimate objective. But one of the issues is around it seems to me at least, would be around privacy and the information that would be held, and the ability to ring fence that information appropriately, consistent with the traditions and the and the constitution of this of this country. So,
in toll, I was going to. My neighbour was. One more question.
Thank you.
I said I'd take, just because she's my neighbour. So.
Thank you.
Okay.
I love the way he says told. I didn't give Ben a choice. I just wanted to ask, if we all agree the population is ageing and there will be a lot more vulnerable individuals using, managing cash, do we not have a responsibility to educate those individuals on their reliance on cash and perhaps to help them become far more digital and less reliant on cash to reduce the level of financial crime, cash crime, but also with that education, they become less of a victim towards digital crime as well?
Can I second that as well, please, Mark? Because looking at the international scene, what we see is financial inclusion. The digital transition has been an enabler for financial inclusion in Asia, and Mohim mentioned earlier that in China they take proactive measures. So is the case in Singapore and in other areas. So in Asia and also in Africa, this is the case, whereas in Europe, we seem to be moving towards a cashless economy by stealth without any active transition program. So we see those vulnerable groups, however we define vulnerable, become more vulnerable and paying that poverty premium, which is so important. So how can we organize ourselves to manage that transition?
I think both comments are very much on point. What we need to do, and we is broader than just the Bank of England, although we can make a contribution to it, and I'll just briefly say what part of ours is, but what we need to do is to put as many people as possible in a position where they choose the means of payment that they want to use, right? So they're not overwhelmed by the either scale of choice on the digital side or unfamiliar and therefore could readily be taken advantage of, or I mean, you follow. It's the nature of your question, I think, posts in the past, Sonia. One of the things we have been doing, and we launched about a year ago, I guess, was to reach out to many more schools in the sort of 11 to 15 age group about how to make financial decisions and increase the familiarity with the changes in the economy. We are on course to reach about, I think we've had, we went from zero to 1,400 schools. Our target was 1,000 schools over a few years, but we went, it showed the sort of unfilled demand, and I would say that just about 90% of those are state schools spread across the country. And what we've done to leverage that is to get a series of our colleagues, if I can use this term, sort of mid-level colleagues, people in their 30s, late 20s, or in their 30s, to go out to schools across the country, so-called bank ambassadors, to answer questions like this with students and increase the familiarity. And we have over 250 of those who are going out. That's one small piece of an overall. It's about how to make financial decisions. That's the core, the sort of principles about how to make financial decisions, which, you know, is in the teach a person to fish is much better than giving a person a fish type spirit. But that obviously needs to be wrapped into a broader financial literacy strategy. I'm going to hand back to you, Ben, but I'll make one other point, which was one of the bigger decisions that needs to be made over the course of several years is around digital identification and the forms of digital identification that people will use, people and companies will use. Again, back to Daniel's question, you know, there are issues around privacy, property rights, others. There's a long tradition of debate in this country, I know, in terms of identity cards and other issues, but unlocking a lot of the opportunities and protections and giving some of the protections in terms of a digital financial system, much of that would be founded on having a consistent and comprehensive digital identification. It's not a decision, obviously, for the bank. It's a much broader decision, needs to be very carefully thought through and debated. But that, and part and parcel of that, can be some of the education that would be needed. And as you say, Sabrina, given the pace of change, these issues become more and more important. Okay, Ben, endogenous money creation. And free banking.
So as Mark said, in most money isn't, not cash. And even these digital payments are simply means of transferring what is still most of the money in our economy, which is deposits in banks. These are claims on the banking system that we each of us have. And those get automatically created when a bank makes a loan. So if the bank extends a loan to a company or individual, when it does that, what it does is fill your, or create or add more to your deposit account. And I mean, it's a balance sheet, it'll say, well, suppose the loan is 10,000 quid or something, and it'll add 10,000 quid to its assets. What it does materially is also add 10,000 quid to your deposit as the borrower. And that's the way that most money gets created, and most money is stored. So I can't remember what the exact numbers are. You said 70 billion of banknotes, bank deposits narrowly defined, probably over a trillion, and broader money measures are more like 1.5 trillion. So banknotes are pretty much a minority. Now, if by the nation's money, that's what you meant, that's how it's created and done. And of course, it's one of the reasons why we have such a big responsibility, as the governor said, in ensuring the safety and soundness of the banking system, and why it was so important to forestall the worst of the financial crisis. Because if the claims on these particular institutions are what we all use to transact, then obviously there's extremely high cost of those institutions, particularly the big ones, failing, which is why we take that responsibility so seriously. So that's the way money is created in the modern economy.
Yeah, really. And so it's helpful to think about, so why can't it just be created with sort of gay abandon and without limit? And there's a couple of reasons, ways that the amount of lending, in Ben's example, is limited. Part of it's limited by Sam and his colleagues, who expect banks to have enough of their own resources in case a loan goes badly, or enough loans go badly, so that they can absorb the losses, so-called bank capital. And what's happened since the financial crisis is those rules have become much stricter. So not surprisingly, after the near-death experience of the financial system, 2007-08, the amount of capital banks has had to hold, the actual requirements for our largest banks have gone up 10 times. The actual amount they're holding has gone up 4 times. So they've got a lot more capital than they used to have. So that's one way that's restricted. The other way it's restricted is another part of what we do, and Ben oversees, is monetary policy. So if we raise interest rates, all things being equal, fewer people and firms are going to ask for a loan, and more people will pay them back. And once they pay them back, both of those dynamics reduces the amount of money in the economy. And part of the judgments we have to make in this room is about getting that balance right. So. That's how we control. If it's not the nation's money, I'm not sure I would use the term the nation's money, but the amount of money in the economy as a whole, that's how we influence it. Richard, you finally got through the doors of the Bank of England, and I know you want to do a very quick follow-up, and then I'm going to pass to Dave.
Well,
yeah, was it worth it after all these years?
It's getting to be worth it. Thank you very much. Okay, may I come back on that? Just
very quickly, and we're going to move on briefly, we can save time at the end if we can.
I really do appreciate you convening this event. It's very good. But I think this is a really crucial issue because, according to what I read, for instance, in James Robertson and Joseph Huber creating new money some time ago, about 2001 or something like that, almost all the money stock of our country belongs not to the nation, but to is borrowed at interest from commercial banks whom you are allowing to create it. Yeah, I mean, 97% at least, that you create banknotes and the cash, that's 3% of the money stock.
I understand the point. So
I think this has been hugely socially damaging. That this is
I'm going to, if I can just jump in, I get the point let me turn it around, okay, which is, what would you rather? Would you rather that I, as governor of the Bank of England, decided every household, who should get a mortgage, who shouldn't, which business should be able to borrow, who shouldn't, what interest I should pay on the deposit? No. We have a system where we have a responsibility to make sure that the value of money holds its value, which Parliament has defined as increasing by that 2% on average in consumer prices each year, so holds its value. We can come back to later on why 2%, not zero, why they think that. We have a responsibility for that, and then we have a responsibility to make sure that those banks are solid enough, banks and building societies, credit unions, solid enough so that they can lend. And then they make the decisions whether, you know, Joe gets a loan for a new business and Sam doesn't, or both do or not. And that's and it's not just one commercial bank, it's a series of banks and building societies, and now, and that's why I'm going to turn to Dave, fintech companies, new types of companies who have different ways of making those determinations. And what that leads to is a more dynamic, resilient economy than, again, because the other alternative, if it were only just the nation's money being distributed by the Bank of England, which, by the way, is another risk with central bank digital currencies, because it could lead us down that path. I think the pitfalls of that system are obvious. Can I go to Dave, if I may, and then we can circle back on this. Thanks. So new topic, but very much related.
New, but very much related. Yeah. So, but just perhaps slightly different framing for the next 20 minutes, but hopefully it will enable us to continue very much the conversations that we've already started. So I want to move us on to the banking for the new world part of the future forum and fintech. Fintech is the buzzword, but financial technology has been with us for decades. We've been talking about, you know, when you could only get money over the counter, then checks, ATMs, contactless, more and more digital. And I think what's striking and why it is now the focus is the pace of change is speeding up, which is why already we've been talking about these issues around inclusion, around protection, but also around the diversity of provision of financial services to try and improve outcomes. Because the pace is speeding up, the dynamics are that much quicker, and we need to think through the implications. That's why fintech is one of the bank's 7 strategic priorities for 2019. And for what I'm going to do is say just a little bit about our strategy based around 3 E's. And then I'm going to hand over to Tom Mutton, who's sitting down there. Tom is our director of our fintech hub, who's going to say a bit more about what the bank is doing in this space to set up a further conversation, which the ramblings of a bard may want to come back in on. I know Sabila has been thinking about a lot of these issues, so I'll turn to them. But so really what we're doing in a nutshell is we're trying to we're embracing fintech. That's the first E, empowering providers of financial services and enabling new technologies and new approaches in the process. And really the embracing, we think we need to embrace fintech because it is important to deliver our mission for monetary and financial stability, as Mark was just emphasizing. I mean, the Monetary Policy Committee has at its heart the value of money, the stability of money through the inflation target. And fintech could change the UK's economy's performance over time in profound ways in terms of productivity and consumer outcomes, business outcomes. Also, more immediately, through as we've just been discussing, how monetary creation works, the transmission of monetary policy and so monetary stability. Then we've got the financial system as a whole through the work of the Financial Policy Committee. And one thing I should have given a plug. John Cunliffe, who couldn't be here today, one of the other deputy governor, Tom Mutton at Ratidzo, Ratidzo Starkey did a fantastic podcast at the end of last week that talks about these financial stability issues, for example, around cryptocurrencies that the FPC looked at. But then there are real benefits potentially from a more, as Mark was just saying, around a more diversified system where risks may get distributed more around the system rather than be concentrated. And then there's SAM's responsibilities for the safety and soundness of individual firms and through the Prudential Regulation Authority and Committee. And there, you know, for those firms, banks, building societies, insurance companies, need to think about in the future whether it makes sense to regulate firms or whether we're going to have to start thinking more about regulating activities and the approach there. So that's really embracing. Empowering is, as we've been discussing already, trying to make sure that we support competition, make sure that these new financial service providers have proportionate supervision and that we're not putting in barriers to their access to the systems that they need to operate in the financial system. And that includes our systems here in the bank, which is the third E, enable. And what we're doing, actually through our direct actions, Mark mentioned this in his opening remarks, we're trying to work on the underlying infrastructure that supports the whole UK financial system, the whole UK payment system, the RTGS system. We were the first bank in the G20 that enabled non-bank payment service providers to have access to it. But this really important issue of data standards that we've been talking about already today, the role of data, which I think is really what's driving this exponential change in financial technologies and multidimensional change, the use of data. Can we, through our suggestions, our recommendations, our active encouragement of data standards, improve the outcomes for those who are using data? But also really important, think about the privacy and governance of data and people's understanding of their own financial needs in a more data, digitally driven economy. So I just wanted to say that as framing. Very quickly, I think Tom will just say a bit more about the specifics of that for the bank, and then I might turn to Sibylla for some reactions.
Well, actually, I might just have a bit of a forward look to 2019, actually. So Dave has kind of said what needs to be said about fintech, I think. But I think 2019 is going to be a really exciting year for fintech. The hub, which I lead in the bank, is going to keep on working really hard to embrace the potential of fintech. There's a few things we're going to do in the year which is coming up. So we're going to keep up our research and our proof of concept experiments to explore how we can use fintech both inside the bank, but also how we can interact with innovators. Our experiments so far have ranged from artificial intelligence through to distributed ledgers. We're going to keep on talking to stakeholders and scanning the horizon to keep up with the latest in fintech. Over the last year or so, we've spoken to over 100 companies, we've presented at more than 30 conferences and events, and we're really keen to keep up the dialogue. And we'll keep on making policy, both at home and internationally, to try and make sure that the conditions exist so that fintech can achieve the benefits, but to do so in a way which is safe and sustainable. I'm really excited to hear what people have to say today, to hear the discussion and to hear the ideas, so I'll probably leave it there, actually.
Thanks, Tom. Sibylla, when we were talking over coffee, you were saying that you both work through an IOD committee that you chair, think about these issues for the UK, but also do a lot of consultancy work, thinking about issues around fintechs, use of data, the the needs for inclusion in more emerging markets. So I don't know if you want to pick up any of those issues.
Yes. Thanks a lot. I think really we have to start with what is fintech and how is it changing the paradigm. And I think the examples from emerging economy we can learn a lot from and see how we can apply them to our mature system. The issue I think we have is we're a mature system and we're trying to embrace new changes, and therefore how do you balance a mature system with new changes that are happening? And they're happening very, very fast. And a number of the central banks that we work with in emerging economies, we're looking at how does fintech improve access to finance. Governor, you originally mentioned about the role that the Bank of England plays with member banks. In emerging economies, some of the examples we're seeing is where central banks have said, right, this is the pot of money we're going to lend you for SME finance or MSME finance, and we're going to do it at a preferential rate, but we want you to achieve X percent of lending to MSMEs. Now, as a nation, I think a lot of us are SMEs around this table, and access to finance is one key issue. The other dimension I'd like to bring in is the gender parity, particularly within SMEs, and gender parity in trade. And I think that is where digital currency has quite a role to play, because you can link digital currency all the way back to supply chain. And if you think of a woman in Africa who's growing avocados and wants to export them to the UK, and if the UK has a digital currency system, which then can then communicate and exchange with an international financial system, this woman with avocados has greater parity in the supply chain finance. So I think those are the sorts of issues that we need to be debating and talking about, is what is the role for the Bank of England in this changing world, maintaining what everyone around the world aspires to, maintaining some of that, but at the same time balancing these changes that are coming in. Another dimension I'd like to bring in is the Bank of Nature. And that is actually at zero reserves at the moment, I would say. We take a lot of this for granted. You know, climate change, issues with soil, dumping of soil. So how can there be a climate central platform or exchange created? So these are some of the things that we're talking about around the world with the IOD hat. We focus very much on future growth horizons, because that is what our members want. And growth is the key to all flourishing economies. And for growth, we are in a mature market, so we look at other markets. And some of the other markets we're looking at, such as India, where there's the other program, which is the digital identification program, which is addressing financial inclusion. It's addressing some of the issues around the elderly. So we look at how we can exchange some of these ideas. And those would be some of the thoughts around what all comes down to in this world of new shifting paradigms. What is the role for a central bank?
Very good.
Fantastic. We're going to be coming back to a lot of those issues, I think, that you were talking about around sustainability, Sabila, in the next session. But Mark, did you want to
react? Yeah, I can. So why don't we talk about climate change and the bank's role in that in the next session, if that's okay. And maybe I can pick up very quickly on SMEs and access to finance and a very interesting gender parity point, a very important gender parity point. On SMEs. So this is a real issue in the United Kingdom. It happens to be an issue in other economies, but it's a big issue in the United Kingdom. We estimate around half of SMEs do not go to the banks, to the formal financial system to finance. So they have kept themselves out of the system. They expect to be frustrated. They self-finance their activities. That needs to change. There needs to be greater access to finance for small, medium-sized enterprises. And we do think that, I mean, just as a static point, if I can put it that way, in terms of the status quo, but also dynamically, because we also do think that the nature of commerce will increase, cross-border trade will increasingly have a SME component, which goes in part to your second point. And so the question is what can be done, and what is the potential role of new financial technologies in helping to bridge this gap and actually provide more competition for those who do go to the formal banking system. And this is within the set of issues we're looking at the bank, and that this is if not the top, one of the top three priorities. We think that there are things that we can do with our core infrastructure, our payment system, the way we the data that we will use, and the access to other central bank facilities that can materially change the access to finance of SMEs, not by us, not directly through us, but creating a the framework for new SME providers to be very active here. Now, I'm not fully laying out exactly what we're contemplating doing, because we want to make sure we have everything lined up. But we do expect to take on some of the lessons and some of the innovations that we have seen in some emerging markets in SME finance, and apply them with the standards and the expectations that be consistent with the UK. So, as a small commercial, I would say watch this space over the course of 2019 for something substantial on that. The issue, your second point, Sibylla, around supply chains, gender parity, and digital currency. I mean, there is a lot in that, and it is anticipating a future that is not yet technically feasible, at least in our judgment. Because in order to, the way I interpret it, in order to affect aspects of the supply chain through innovations in money, you do need an effective distributed ledger on scale that works, works in all circumstances, that is efficient, that can support a smart contract, for example, that runs across the supply chain, take advantage of big data and other aspects. That is conceptually possible, but practically not. And we're really, in terms of distributed ledger technology, and we have run a lot of trials with this, others have as well, we're not yet at a point where it can effectively work. So we have seen some in trade finance, which is to be commended, and UK private financial institutions doing some of this innovation, but it's still early days, and to have it run all the way through a supply chain is not yet feasible. But we're working, as many others are, towards that possibility. The last point I'll make on it is that this issue, which links both of these SMEs and supply chains, is one of the big things, and one of the other top priorities for the work we're doing on fintech, is to get the cost of cross-border payments down substantially. And the cost of cross-border payments can be up to 10 times the cost of domestic payments. Both of those need to come down substantially, but there will always be exchange rate risk with cross-border payments, but there's no real reason why there should be anything like that gap, if any gap at all, between a cross-border payment and a domestic payment. And there's various ways, and we're working with other central banks as one example, to just plug the systems together, if I can put it crudely, so that we get rid of that those types of gaps. So these are your questions and your challenges touch on exactly the type of issues we're trying to address.
Anyone else want to come in on these issues? I was going to say, Gareth, I don't know if you've got any that are coming in from tweets in this kind of space. We certainly had a lot when we were running the platform on this.
We have plenty. This is one of the areas that certainly generates a lot of interest externally. For example, a question that's just come in from someone called at Love for Crypto 17, which I suspect may give an indication of where they stand on this, but asking whether we think that laws are going to be passed that are going to let banks here be able to hold digital assets on their balance sheets this year. Do we expect that to happen to move things forward?
Sam, do you want to...
Yeah, I'm very happy to take that, and I think it illustrates how this whole area, it throws up opportunities and tensions for us as a central bank, and back to what should the role of the central bank be. So crypto is a great example. I don't know if any of you have been out to Korea lately, South Korea, I presume, if you have. But they obviously had an enormous issue with crypto, and speaking to our colleagues there, that was actually quite difficult for them to get their arms around. Now, here in the UK, the interface between the financial system and crypto assets and crypto technology more widely has not been sufficient to make us think it's a financial stability risk, but it has led me, on behalf of the prudential regulation part of the bank, to write to the banks and say, if you are going to hold it, you need to do it in such and such a way and take some care with it. Because one of the funny things about bank regulation is if it's held in a certain way, they don't have to hold any capital against it, and that's back to the point that Mark was saying before. If you have that in the system, that's a dangerous thing to have. And just while I've got the floor, I wonder if I can very briefly point to one other area of opportunity and tension that we have in this space, which is about the approach we take to new banks.
So can I just stop you there for one sec? So just make sure we're answering the question. What you're saying is, which I think is right, is you can hold crypto on balance sheet. It has an economic cost, and it has a responsibility of the bank to satisfy issues such as anti-money laundering and counterterrorism financing in terms of the provenance of the Bitcoin or whatever crypto asset is used. And one of the, no point dancing around it, one of the uses of these assets, crypto assets, is money laundering. And proceeds of crime. Now, it's not the only use, but it is one of the uses. And so that puts a burden on the institution in accepting it to make sure that that chain is satisfied. But sorry, Sam.
Yeah, and I judge this response may not satisfy the question, judging from their name. Just briefly on the new banks thing, I just think it's interesting. I wish I could do a spontaneous Menti poll and ask people around the room how many new banks they think we've authorized in the UK in the last 5 years. The actual number is 39, which is quite a lot higher than most people think. And within that, there's a whole range of different sorts of institutions. And I think it's absolutely essential that we do that because of the objectives that we have, which include facilitating competition. But it is, I would say, an outlying approach amongst our colleagues internationally. And when we explain how we've approached this and the way in which we've encouraged new bank entry and the risks that we're choosing to run by having a more open system, it's sometimes regarded as surprising by colleagues with a different approach in other jurisdictions.
Thanks, Sam. Gareth, you've got some more?
I would like to just give us a chance to make sure we cover all the topics and just to sort of bring the first two together in a way, because we've talked a bit about financial literacy. I should warn at the end, I am going to bring Jack back in after the third session on this, I think. But talked a bit about financial literacy and people's behaviour. We're now talking about fintech in a slightly more macro way and thinking about the industry itself. I'd like to turn to Mentimeter again now, actually, so people could get their devices back up and just answer a second question on this, which is, if you can get your devices ready, you should be able to see, bringing those two together, do you think that technology has actually had a positive influence on our financial behaviours? As you can see, either yes, for example, because it streamlines my transactions, no, because it makes it too easy for me to spend money I don't have. C, sometimes, but I do prefer human interaction. Or D, I don't know yet.
Striking how few undecideds
something
there
different.
Are. People have an opinion.
At the end.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Strong opinion, stronger than I would have expected too.
And this has been going out as well, hasn't it, on the platform? This.
The yellow set.
Which brings us to the forward-looking part, I think, of the agenda. Can I hand to Joe now to talk in a way, a slightly more kind of forward-looking part, thinking about Bank to the Future is the title of that.
Yeah, I particularly want to just pick up on climate change, actually. Sabina mentioned this, and what was very clear in the Future Forum was that people were quite surprised and possibly sceptical of what we were doing in the area of climate change and really what role a central bank had. Now, obviously, it's the government that sets the policy and the legislation on the environment, and that's right. But this is a massive risk for the financial sector. So banks and insurers, they really face a big risk from climate change. So we've been doing a lot of work going to talk to the industry about how they're managing that risk, because we believe that if you actually think about the risk, then you can think about how to mitigate it as well. So we've been talking to them, both banks and insurers, about how they factor it into their business models. We're considering putting it in our stress test, and we're also thinking about and talking to them about how they manage this at board level. And in fact, we're doing a piece of work that we expect to be published later this year on how the industry should discuss that and manage it at board level. We've had many seminars, workshops, conferences, speeches, which you may have seen, to raise awareness and also to think about practical actions. We've also recently established a forum, the Climate Financial Risk Forum, with the Financial Conduct Authority to bring practitioners together again to share best practice and to discuss this as well. I'm going to pass on to my colleague Teresa in a moment, who's been working in this area, and she can say a little bit more detail about what we've done. But I think all of us as individuals have felt the impact of environmental changes and what we can do personally and what we can do in our companies. This has been sort of slow and steady over the last 10 to 20 years, but I think it's fair to say that over the last 2 or 3 years, this has really gained momentum. If you look at companies now in terms of their corporate and social responsibilities, what they're doing, we're no different to that in the bank. We try to reduce our use of single-use containers. We've set ourselves a carbon target. We've got green champions, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm sure a lot of all your companies are doing the same as well. But I'll pass on to Teresa to say a little bit more detail about what we're doing with the financial services sector.
Thank you. So work on climate change is part of our role of maintaining financial stability and to make sure the banks and insurers we supervise are safe and sound. So as Joe mentioned, banks and insurance companies face a lot of financial risks from climate change, and those include physical risks, for example, the risk of increased flooding or more extreme seasons. But those are not risks that might just happen at some point in the future. We're already seeing some of those materialise now. For example, weather-related losses, insurance losses, have increased fivefold over the last few decades. And to deal with the global warming, the economy has to transition and change, and has to transition to a low-carbon economy where we reduce greenhouse gases dramatically. That shift in the economy can lead to other sudden shifts, for example, in the price of carbon-intensive assets. And the banks and insurers that hold those assets would be affected by those changes. That's what we refer to as the transition risk to firms. So you might think that firms should manage this risk in the same way that they manage all the other risks that they face. But there's a few reasons why the risks from climate change are different. One is that, unlike other issues, climate change is going to impact every sector and every country. And while we know that everyone will be impacted, we don't know how they will be impacted. The other unique factor about climate change is that we need to act today to make sure we can actually mitigate the worst impact from climate change and to ensure that we can achieve a smooth transition to a low carbon economy. So given the unique risks from climate change, we're thinking and we're working with insurance and insurers and banks to think about how we best manage the transition and how we best manage those financial risks. And as Joe's already mentioned, there's a few different things, initiatives, such as the Risk Forum, to work with industry and help them develop a way of managing risks. We are also part of the Network for Greening the Financial System. So this is a network of central banks and regulators to work together to share best expertise across countries, because we recognise that this is a global issue, and to try to deal with the challenges that climate change poses together.
Teresa, thank you very much.
And just put a couple numbers around all of that. The risks that Teresa just described, physical risks, floods, and transition risks, the change as we move to a low-carbon economy and as these risks increase and opportunities increase. The financial sector needs to take a view on that, people who invest money, banks who lend against insurance companies. And for that, they need information. So one of the things that the bank has done is to help catalyze a private initiative to find out what type of information the market needs. As of today, there's $100 trillion of assets behind that initiative. Now, if that sounds like a lot of money, it is a lot of money. It's it's $100 million of assets. That's saying to companies, we want you to disclose what impact climate is having on you today and what it potentially is going to have on you in the future. So those people who invest our pension funds or lend out our savings in a building society or bank can make those determinations of which companies have thought about this, which are going to face bigger risks because of it, and which are going to have bigger opportunities. And that's part of the way that this will change. Now, as Teresa said, and Joe said, the policy itself is climate policies are policy of governments, and not just the UK government, but governments around the world. But the market will get behind those changes as they come into effect. Simon.
So, hi. Yeah. I represent Positive Money, and we're an organization, an NGO, trying to do research and campaigns to reform the money and banking system so it's fairer, more democratic and sustainable. And we actually polled a lot of our supporters. We represent thousands of supporters across the country, and over 1,000 came back, and they actually said that 22% of them said that climate change is the most pressing issue for the Bank of England right now. 35% said inequality, 19% said risk of a financial crash, 13% high private debt, 9% high house prices, 1% inflation, et cetera, et cetera.
Shows you what a good job we're doing on inflation.
but anyway, the point is, I think a lot of people feel that the Bank of England isn't doing enough about climate change. Considering the IPCC tells us we've got 12 years to sort things out, and you talk about the disclosure, and it's been disappointing, I think, that the Bank of England hasn't put its money where its mouth is. Mm-hmm. It's done corporate QE, £10 billion into financial markets, mainly buying up bonds from companies involved in finance and fossil fuels. And so you talk about disclosure, but you're not doing it for your own risks. And you're the most powerful institution in the financial sector. There are people pouring money into fossil fuels. I'm sorry, but...
Yeah, question?
Why aren't you doing everything in your power to stop it?
So one of the things here, Simon, I mean, and I appreciate your going out and polling and getting the feedback, and there are a few other issues on your list which hopefully we'll touch on. In terms of climate policy, so and this it's part of the way, and one of the issues you had there was democratic, and it's part of how a democratic system works. Who is responsible for climate policy? Who's responsible for tax policy? Who's responsible for foreign policy in the United Kingdom? It's the government of the United Kingdom, and subject to Parliament. And so we have very specific responsibilities that are given to us by governments. And our responsibilities are the thing that your poll is least worried about, monetary stability, inflation being low, stable, predictable, and the health of the financial system. So what we have said with respect to climate is that we can see a future risk, in some cases, in insurance, for example, that it has present implications, but for banks and others, it's a future risk that the system has to get ready for. And I think it's fair to say that we have led amongst central banks in this thinking, but certainly amongst the leaders, if not the leader, in thinking about how the system has to get ready for the risk. Now, the second thing is that, and we have catalyzed a lot of changes internationally. That $100 trillion figure is a significant, that is more, that's 20% more than global GDP. Again, to put a number around it, just in terms of the scale of interest in which companies are taking these risks seriously, which companies aren't, which have opportunities, which are part of the problem, which are part of the solution. That's what that means. Now, disclosure is disclosure about what your risks are, where your opportunities are, how much greenhouse gases you emit, how much you plan to emit in the future, those types of issues. Disclosure is not making those decisions for companies. It's either you're there or it's providing the information for the market to then make a decision. With respect to, and last point, with respect to the purchases that the bank makes, if the bank ever makes purchases of securities, whether they're gilts, so government bonds issued by Her Majesty's government, or in the case that you referenced, corporate bonds, so issued by companies, we are very conscious to make those purchases in a way that doesn't distort the market. Because if we distort the market, we are making, unelected officials are making a political decision. If somebody wants to change the tax system, if somebody wants to accelerate our climate policies, if somebody wants to build more schools or hospitals, or fewer, for that matter, those decisions are taken by elected officials through Parliament. If somebody is concerned about keeping inflation low, stable, predictable, a financial system being secure, and adjusting the future of the financial system in a way that's consistent with those, that responsibility is devolved in a very specific way to the Bank of England. We can affect those. And climate comes into that in the sense of what the future of the system might be.
And just, do you mind if I add very quickly that, Mark, which is just to say, remember that that decision on that aspect of QE equally, I mean, that was by a committee of people, the Monetary Policy Committee, that is directly accountable to Parliament. And that committee, on which the Governor and I sit, and they thought, you know, considered that very carefully. And it was very clear that everyone on that committee, including the four external members, who have no business but to account to Parliament on these questions, that is their only reporting line, they don't work for the Bank of England, were very clear that it was very important that we should step back and buy what the market was, rather than skewing decisions this way and that. And that is their primary responsibility. It is monetary policy is their responsibility. Yeah. Their responsibility to hit the inflation target, nothing else. And I think it's quite important that people fulfill the responsibilities they're asked to fulfill and not other things, which is...
Can I just bring in, Michael, can I hold you for 1 second, Armin, since you haven't spoken, can I bring you in and then, yeah.
All right. Well, I just wanted to refer to, well, you mentioned climate risk, climate change as a massive risk. It was mentioned earlier on. I think it's a massive responsibility, first of all. I think the terminology we use when we refer to climate change needs to be adjusted. And I'm going to link to something that you have, Governor, before suggested, that climate change is the tragedy of the horizon. But it's also the tragedy at the horizon.
Yes, exactly. Right? Yep.
And I would like to link it back to the choice of the bonds and why the justification, whether it's Parliament or not Parliament, because I think we have a value paradigm issue. It's not about the people who were on that committee. It's not about who that committee is responsible to. It's the entire monetary value paradigm we have, which is the issue. That's also the reason why you have qualified climate change as the tragedy of the horizon, because we have two principles that govern our entire value framework: time value of money and risk and return. That's the entire imaginative space that we use to build our equations, our models, to choose the bonds which are credit worthy enough to be used for monetization and or not. But if we were to include the space impact of investments as integral as the risk or the time value, the question of who should have promoted the healthy impact bonds disappears, because we would have automatically, all government Bank of England injections would have been optimized for space impact, not just for credit rating or credit worthiness, but also to optimize the, in a healthy way, the responsibility of impact. But we don't have these principles in our system, in our value framework.
It's a very interesting, it's quite a deep point. And it gets to a point around, within a system, different discount rates, if I can put it that way. So the point, and if you're not familiar, I did make a speech three and a half years ago, setting out this issue, which is that the tragedy of the horizon around climate is once it becomes a clear and present danger, and I'm not quoting a Jack Ryan movie, actually, I'm quoting a study of the issue for the United States in entering the Second World War, which it wasn't a clear and present danger, was the argument, but it was ultimately a danger, and therefore they entered. Is the thing. But the until when the physical manifestations are such, then it's too late. And the issue is that which is the branch of society that has the discount rate that assesses the problem of the future and brings it to the present and brings the action in the present that will solve the issue in the future. And very clearly and transparently, and it goes back to how you organize a democracy and who has that responsibility and who doesn't, and how in a democracy you cannot appropriate powers onto yourself to say, I'm worried about this geopolitical issue, I'm worried about climate, I'm worried about that aspect, and I'm going to use my instruments, which are here for keeping banks sound, in order to try and solve that issue, which is rightly the responsibility of government. The tragedy on climate, can be the tragedy, is that it is beyond those physical manifestations, when it becomes clear that it's absolutely that risk, it's beyond the horizon of most financial actors. A bank tends to lend for 3, 4, 5 years, has that type of horizon. Inflation, we can get inflation back to target within 2 or 3 years. Therefore, we have that horizon. In fact, we explicitly have that horizon in terms of what Parliament tells us to do. But we can see that some of these risks are being brought into the present as the system changes. So we have brought them forward, and Joe and Teresa went through how we're overseeing some of our. But there are limits to that. You can't expect one central bank in order to solve that. The issue becomes whether governments, expressing people's preferences, are taking that longer-term horizon, as you say, pulling space into the equation of the discount rate, and then taking policies today that then make the framework. Now, what we do in terms of, and I'll finish on this, in terms of bank risk and disclosure and other things, is we create the information set so that if somebody thinks, a company thinks, or an investor thinks, or a bank thinks, that actually the horizon is going to change because action is going to be brought forward, then they adjust their investment accordingly. Now, I've left out a huge other force of change, which is that individuals themselves, in terms of their preferences, how they shop, how they live, who they give their money to invest, who they keep it away from, they can have that effect. And I will say that one of the things that is developing, and Joe mentioned in the course of the last few years, is there is an increasing sense amongst a variety of companies, including major investing companies, that, and apologize for the jargon, but purpose-driven or ESG, environmental, social governance investing will be increasingly important, because that's the underlying and expressed preference of people. People actually move their money, and that's how the system works. So sorry, I realize this is very good discussion, but we're getting late in the afternoon. So Mike, can I go to? I promised I'd go to you, and you.
I guess the point I was going to make is that, and I think I'm right in saying that in spite of £375 billion of QE, we still had less money in the system. the control isn't really with the Bank of England. The people making these decisions and allocating new money are private managers in private banks.
Yeah, so one of the things, I'll put it in a shorthand if I can, which is the system, I don't think this is a secret, it's an open secret if it's a secret, that the system could have been managed better prior to the crisis. Okay, first point. and one of the problems in the system at the time was, and Sam wasn't on the case at the time, but in Sam's world, the banks were allowed to lend a lot more relative to that capital that they had, the protection. They were allowed to lend a lot more. And when the crisis hit, that lending collapsed, and the amount of money in the system collapsed with it. QE, it's for different reasons, it's not, but QE effectively was leaning against some of that collapse by injecting money in the system. I this is the point where I say, for the purposes of this is a popular discussion, but there are some who listen to it from a market perspective, where I declare that we are not monetarists at the Bank of England, despite talking about money. So we, lest anyone think that we thought it was purely a monetary change. But to your point, there is that offset from QE. I'm afraid we're losing the youth of Britain in this discussion. Jack, Ian, do you want to come very quickly?
Yeah, I'd very quickly to come in, because I was just wanting to work out a sort of distinction. You talked about risk, and I think when somebody turned risk to responsibility, they were onto something that I understood. But it seems that you, as the bank, you talked about good practice in the bank, all right? And it struck me that when you are actually doing your normal functions, you also have a responsibility with the good practice of that and the consequences of that. So it's not a question of you should be doing more, but doing it at that sort of way. But it left me with two questions. Oh, sorry. The insurance, actually, the risk is very much more immediate.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's one point. The other point is, and we've worked in social capital, which has some of the same sort of issues, is how do we actually calibrate this in a meaningful way? And how do you say how much climate risk there is? How do you actually be able to sort of turn it into figures and so on, so that actually somebody confronting Unilever or somebody like, say, you know, that's what you're saying, but actually, what is the calibration? How does it stand? And so on. And I think that would be very useful in the boardroom and amongst shareholders and so on. You asked me to be brief. So
no, it's fantastic. Very, very brief, and I'll answer, if I may, just very briefly. In terms of the second part of your question, there are examples, and actually Unilever's disclosure is a very good example in terms of disclosing climate risk, including scenarios where if the world goes to 1.5 or 2 degrees, what's the implication for their current business lines and the impact, and what would they need to do if climate restrictions were greater. And they also disclose how executive compensation is affected relative to these objectives. All of that is being put together in a report that's going to go to the G20 summit in Osaka in June, which shows best practice for disclosure of over 2,000 companies around the world. So who does it well, who doesn't, what the learnings. And so the sort of excuse of we don't know how to disclose it, or maybe I put it more positively, the examples will be given. Will be given to them. Your first question was around insurance, or your first point was around insurance. It's absolutely right. Okay. And if anyone wonders about the impact of climate change, all they have to do is go see the property and casualty companies and reinsurance companies that Sam and his colleagues oversee, because these are the most sophisticated managers of climate risk in the world, because they have that exposure. And so they adjust their pricing and coverage very quickly in advance of it. And there was a good reason why, you kindly referenced that speech, there's a good reason why I gave it at Lloyd's of London, because they're the ones who were out in front in terms of these risks. Speaking of being out in front, we're behind.
Here conversation. We are. So very quick. Just very quickly first, I just want to draw a line under the climate change conversation in a sense, not around the issue, but the conversation here this afternoon, which is very quickly, if you can go to your Mentimeter again, just to check the sense around the room, how pressing is climate change as an issue? First, urgent action today. Second, maybe other issues affecting the UK are more urgent. We've blissfully not mentioned the B word today at any point, so maybe you think that's more important. Not until 2030, or we shouldn't waste time. It's interesting. I questioned the relevance of this question because I thought everything would be yellow, but interesting that it's not. Others thinking there may be other more urgent things that affect the UK today. Okay, so we've had three sessions. I'm very conscious that a lot of this is about the future, and the next generation haven't really had a chance to give their view. And there's been a lot of people. Old like me talking. We actually have these three people around this table who one can think of as representing next generation. We have Thomas, who's a sixth former. We've got Susie, who is a member of the British Youth Council. And we've also got Jack, who's Bristol Youth Mayor. Maybe Jack, I could just come to you in the first instance, whether there's anything across any of the sessions on financial literacy or anything else that you wanted to put your thoughts forward on or ask a question on.
Firstly, I think I should be completely honest and say I did get an economics lesson from my brother before I came here. he's doing A-level economics and I did not, so I think that's helped me a lot. But I think that highlights a real issue in that there are 20 kids in this class out of a school of 700, and they're the 20 who understand what's going on in here.
Yeah.
And I think Sonia touched on it, the education side of it, and how I had a look at the Knowledge Bank, the set up by the Bank of England, and that's a more individual approach to educating people about the Bank of England and what it does, but the resources there aren't very relevant to be used in classrooms, which is where it's effectively taught. Now, the information there is probably, well, is right and is relevant, but I was wondering if the bank has any policies to maybe not so they have to go into schools, but teach the teachers, because you've got your bank ambassadors, but there's only so far they can reach.
I'll do it. Yep. Okay. Are we collecting these, or are we responding?
Well, I think
so. Exactly right. So what we're trying to do, Jack, is meet requests for information about the bank and learning about the bank at the level that people want to consume it. So there's some lot of real techie stuff with lots of acronyms, and you know, only a very subset of people want to see it, but they want to see everything and they can, and we provide that to them. Knowledge Bank is sort of a mid-level type approach, which explains what we do, but it's kind of, if you're interested about the bank, as opposed to you're interested about just making, about economics or how to make decisions. So what we are doing, and we started about a year ago, it's really only in the first year, is going out to schools. And we have teaching modules, it's called Economy, with the M-E, yeah, it's very clever. I didn't have anything to do with it, but it's called that. And they are teaching modules they're for teachers. When we go out and supplement if we can, but it's about how to make a decision. So smartphone contract should you buy, and what are some of the decision factors, and gives you a sense of discounting money and contingent payments and those various things. And it's a way to expose students to some of the concepts in economics that they either intuitively know or they deal with every day, link a bit to this is the bigger economic picture, and hey, by the way, there's this thing called the Bank of England. And the hope is that you at least spark the interest around these subjects and teach something. And for a few students who wouldn't otherwise think about the Bank of England or the civil service or economics or finance, that it sparks that interest and they become more engaged in it. Because one of the big things big focuses we've had at the bank, and one of the big needs we have in the financial sector as a whole, is much greater diversity diversity of background, perspective, type of things that people study, we're very keen to improve that. So We're on the path. We're going to hit about 10% of schools in the country. We'd like to ramp that up, and we'd also like to move it to an A level. And I will say one thing, and I'll let you come in. This project cost £85,000. And so we're getting out to 1,400 schools, you know, tens of thousands of kids. That's a fantastic return on investment.
Yeah.
I'm quite nervous. So I personally believe in this topic because I am currently in my first year of sixth form and I take economics, and that's the only reason why I know about interest rates and why that is concerning. However, my friends, they don't take economics or they don't take any economic related subjects either. And they, from my knowledge, they don't know quite a lot about finance. And I don't think many of the people that I hang around with know quite a lot about finance either. And that opposes like a threat to the country because there is just a bunch of kids that does not know anything about finance or how to save or what interest rates are. And it just shows that we could do much more.
Great. First off, Malvika, those are incredibly important points. It's great that you've got engaged, and it does have a knock-on effect. I mean, that's one of the things as you're trying to spread knowledge, is you meet people like you. You go to some of the schools up and down the country. You raise the issues. People see that the people who are dealing with these issues are kind of just like that. I mean, one of the only merits of me going to schools around the country is people think, well, if that guy can be governor of the Bank of England, I can be governor of the Bank of England. That's exactly the point. That's exactly the point, is you want to bring people in. Yeah. But yes, and I think the challenge we have, or the challenge we're sort of setting ourselves is, okay, we've started down this road. Who else can we work with? How do we get this to scale? There's lots of good private initiatives. Martin Lewis and other people have important initiatives for financial education. But your big point, which is that it's a risk for the country, or it's an opportunity for the individuals, maybe is a better way to put it. It's a huge opportunity, and we need to do better. You're right. Susie.
I was just going to raise something that I was kind of piecing together what you guys were talking about, cryptocurrency, and I'm kind of in the same boat. I don't know, I'm really trying to piece things together. But I actually had quite a lot of concern about that. And in personal experience, similar to these guys, a lot of my friends don't know about economics, or they might, because I live in a very rural area, they don't have a relationship with the bank, really. Like they have an online bank account their parents set up for them when they were 12, and now they just go with it. But it actually concerns me how much they're in the know about Bitcoin, and they're in the know about, let's say, the dark web. Or I had someone that I used to be friends with who used to sell drugs online, and it was all through Bitcoin. He had a little SD card he'd stick into his computer. And I guess for me, it was quite a big concern that my generation and the people that I was around were more keyed up on that rather than how they can manage their own finances. So I guess just in terms of the bank facilitating cryptocurrency or whatever, Bitcoin, whatever you want to call it, I think similar to something a friend was saying to me is when you introduce the internet, there wasn't necessarily rules that went with it. And now we have the dark web, cyber abuse, things like that.
Yeah.
And it's like, if there's cryptocurrency, then there needs to be so much rules and regulations and standards there. Because otherwise, you've already got people taking the opportunity and doing what they will with it. And I just think it's a really, for me, that was probably what came out the most concerning, is just in my experience, that is a big red flag. And I wouldn't encourage more of it myself, but I understand that it's got a place in where we're going in the future.
Hallelujah. I'd just like to make sure. I'm totally where you are. I thought fairly clear last year that I personally don't see the value in these crypto assets as currency. They're not going to displace sterling and others. I do see the downsides in terms of their use for illicit activity. They're incredibly environmentally wasteful. Bitcoin uses more power for 7 transactions a day than Visa does for 65,000 a second. And on and on and on. I mean, it's we do think that if those crypto assets touch the formal financial system, they should be regulated in a similar way. Now, what I do think we think as well is that the other aspects of a crypto asset or cryptocurrency, the idea that it's digital, that it's what we haven't jumped to, some of what the demand for, not the illicit, you know, purposes, but the other demand, which is you can have digital money that instantly moves between accounts. So right now, I mean, we can all send money to each other and faster payments and all that. That's great. We can use contactless cards, but we can't yet, and we will be able to soon. I can't send money from my account to my smartphone to your smartphone instantaneously everywhere. So Dave, when he's at the pub and forgets his wallet because he's doing the cashless challenge,
left it at home.
He should have been able to just jump money from his phone to someone else. And so it's that leg of the system that I think younger people, other people expect. And so we need to get to that phase very quickly.
Do you mind if I just ask you a question? Because I can see two drawbacks, the example you use. Are they interested in Bitcoin because it's anonymous, which relates to the debates we were having earlier about trade-off between privacy and this activity, or because it was, for a while at least, a speculative asset that happened to be going up in value by 25% a year until, of course, it didn't, and then
I don't think it was the second one. I don't think he knew
not.
That. I think
it was purely because it was
purely
the
anonymous.
And I think
and this is what I was thinking the whole time. I was like, if you've got, like, why do we need anonymous? Like, why? And I get it, but then I don't get it. I'm just like, if you're going to introduce something and give someone that opportunity, that is going to grant free access for so much.
Indeed.
And it's just like, can you really, like, sure, it has benefits, but the, like, drawbacks, just to me, I just think it would be an absolute nightmare, because I've seen people grow up and that's what they turn to first. Like, you've got completely normal people living in a rural area, and for some reason, based on what is published on the internet and that kind of enticement, that's what they go for. And it's just like, if you're going to put that up, then, like, expect nightmare. That's what I've experienced. But it is definitely the anonymity they go for.
It's really interesting, some of the developments that we're seeing, as Mark was saying, in the underlying technology in financial services. They're going down the route of not these permissionless systems where you, but actually, it's what it's called in the jargon. It's a system where it has to be permissioned, so someone has to know, some controller of the system has to know what's going on, because then you can control it. And that may work better for a developing a benign version of the technology. But as Mark was saying, we've been very clear. We were part of the authorities, the UK authorities crypto assets task force, where we really stressed, along with the Treasury and the Financial Conduct Authority, that if this touches the financial system in the legal financial system, then we need to think about, might it need to be regulated across exchanges. And the like. If we've got time to come on to the films that the kids have produced for our challenge, quite a lot of those films, because I was one of the judges, get into these darker aspects of the future, which so it reinforces your point about, but also they're quite profound.
So this is on the dark web. I haven't.
I'll just so people are aware here. On the same theme of future of money, we've been running a competition for schools called Bank Camera Action, giving them a chance to produce films that pick up on that theme in any way they see fit. We had some brilliant entries this year in particular, actually. We are going to show just a couple now, as I say, on the broad theme of future of money, a couple of the winners in different categories, I think.
Thank you. With me, Kenneth Pound. New Shushin, the Bank of England, is about to announce a brand new system that will apparently revolutionise the way that we spend our money. We're going straight over to James, our financial correspondent, who is in that London.
Thanks, Gareth. I'm here outside the Bank of England in that London with the head of technology, Roger Halfpenny. Roger, could you tell us a little bit about your system that you've called the High Five system?
Certainly, James. Well, High Five actually stands for Hand Interface 5. This new system will allow people to make small transactions without the need for cash, cards, or electronic devices.
So how does the system work?
Well, as you can see, for the sake of demonstration, we've both been implanted with the High Five chip, which will allow us to implement the system. In order to make a transaction, I simply hold my hand up. And if you bring your palm to mine, as you can see, a £5 transaction has been made from your account to my account. Ta-da!
Okay, now I understand that the bank has created a public information film to coincide with the launch of the new system.
We have indeed, James, and I believe we're about to see the world premiere of it. Owe money? High five! No change for a taxi? High five! Forget a birthday? High five! Parking fine? High five! Lost your purse in the shop? High five! Getting bullied? High five! High five has been proven to reduce bullying by 85%. It literally costs the bully to bully. Genius! High five! Yes! High five! 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 And there you have it, folks. The future of money is here.
Could I have my fiver back?
No.
Just a couple. I think it demonstrates we are getting increasing amounts of engagement from schools, and it's showing how aware and thinking about this some of the topics are. We are doing our best on schools education. It's my area that's working on this, and I would really take your point. One thing I would just say, Jack, is we are doing a lot of work with teachers to try and train teachers. We've got workshops on sort of professional development for teachers around the country coming up, which is one thing. That last film made me think it's one way that we can get Dave to actually buy drinks in the pub when he always says he's doing it. Last point before I hand over to the Governor to summarise, just one last Mentimeter question, which in some ways is my favourite of the two, even though it's of the questions, even though it's only got two options, which is, will you be carrying cash in 10 years' time?
2:48.
Staggering. I would have thought that it wouldn't be very long ago where you'd have got a very different answer to that question. I should say it comes in with a lag, and we will keep monitoring this because we're getting questions in from outside, but they're taking time to come through the system. So we will put on our website where this one ended up, along with all the other Mentimeter questions. But before I tell everyone where you can go downstairs and have some refreshments and meet one another, I will hand over to the Governor to close.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Gareth. Thank you all for coming in today and participating over the last few weeks and those online and for continued submissions. Very interesting. Those are both fantastic entries in the schools competition. And what underscores it about money is money is a social convention. People accept money because others accept it. Whether it's high fives and the sort of feel good that come from that, or whether it is followers. In Paula's example, I should congratulate Calder for their high fives, but Paula's example with followers and in place. And of course, one of the things we know is around data. Data is as money, and money that in some cases not compensated that we're trading off. And where ultimately does that end up? And where does it end up in terms of social credit, to use another term, and a whole other set of issues? By the way, when I, Simon, if it's any help, when I in my native Canada, the positive money of its day was called social credit, which was a form of helicopter drop money in the Great Depression. So a parallel currency that was. It didn't work, actually, but it was just historical fact. But the I think both of those videos, this conversation, the range of this conversation, gives a sense of just how much has changed and will change with money, and because it's a social convention, because it exists, because it's a means to an end, it's hugely important for us to get your feedback, your perspective, what you want, what society wants, and then to explain what we're doing in that context. And I think this conversation will just widen out and widen and deepen in the coming years, given the pace and potentially breadth of change. So thank you all, and I'll close officially this. Thanks to those online. And we'll look forward to having a cup of tea and continuing the conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.